Hello and welcome to another Solana tutorial. Today we're gonna talk about Solana development basics. This is the first video in a series of videos about the Solana development course. I've got my semi-professional green screen set up. Let's have a look. Boom, we're here. I don't like that. That was different. No, annoying. Oh, if the light changes, then this changes. Anyhow, we gotta live with semi-professional. That's what we do. Anyhow, pointy. Look at me. I'm shiny. And I wanna tell you about the Solana development course. This is open source. There is a GitHub repo. You can go check that out. That's the entire course in source files. But it's also deployed to soldev.app/course. And it consists of 4 modules and some sections each. And in this video series, we're gonna go through them. Now, if you prefer to go through it on your own, of course you can. Just go there and do it by yourself. I encourage you to do that. This video series is not to replace that course. It's more of an add-on, an additional resource for the people who prefer to have it shown to them. Like me, I don't like to read. I like if people tell me what I should do. So I am here to tell you what to do. Ha! Yeah, right? Right? This is how this works. So today we're gonna start with module 1, client interaction with the Solana network. By the way, this video is brought to you by the Solana Foundation. More on them later. I'm such a sellout. Yes, sellout to Solana. I even wear their shirts and I even have it in my name. What are we gonna learn? So essentially, this video, maybe that's what I forgot. This video is for people who want to start developing on Solana. And you know, there are several steps. First, we gotta interact. Then we interact with state. We interact with programs. Then we program on Solana, and then we do some more complicated programming on Solana. This is the outline. So if you wanna learn how to program on Solana, this course is for you. And if you're a lazy person, then this video series might be for you. However, I do suggest that you code alongside me, right? If you just watch it, it's the same if you just read through it. You're not gonna learn it. You wanna actually do it in order to get some practice, in order to actually be able to develop in the future. So we're gonna learn what accounts are. That's a good start. I made a video on that long time ago. Maybe I should revise that as well, but we're gonna redo that. Like, I haven't done the course yet. I have no idea how long this is gonna take. Gonna just see what happens. Sol and lamports, important concept. What public keys are, what the JSON RPC is, Web3.js, so the basics, right? In this first video, we're gonna go through the very, very basics. And because we're lazy, we're gonna also just start with the TLDR to get some terms defined. An account, very important concept in Solana. Accounts are like the files on the Solana network. I always hear that analogy. Accounts on Solana are like files. Cause I mean, kinda they are. That's the thing that stores state. All state data is stored in an account. What I said, literally what I said, I'm so smart. Accounts can be used for many things, but for now we'll focus on the aspect of accounts which store Sol. So yes, since everything is an account, there are all sorts of different accounts. If you've been around this channel for a while, then we heard about token accounts. We heard about token mint accounts. Candy Machine has an account to store all the information. And here in this first thing, we're gonna use the most primitive account, which is just an account that holds Sol, which is what you might know as a wallet, right? So it's just one address that holds some amount of Sol. Sol being the native currency of Solana. That's also what you pay transaction fees and storage fees in. We probably talk about rent, but not yet. Lamports. So a lamport is like a millionth of a Sol, so 9 zeros. If you have an amount of Sol, add 9 zeros at the end and you'll have your lamports. Easy as that. Public keys, also often referred to as addresses, point to accounts in the Solana network. So the account is what actually holds the... and the address tells us where it's stored. Because the accounts on Solana is essentially a giant hash map where for each public key, you can quickly find the corresponding account in storage. Yes, so the public key, I will probably say addresses, but the public key derived from the private key you can use to find an account. Okay.
While you must have a specific secret key to perform certain functions within an account, anyone can read account data with your public key.
Yes, Solana is a public blockchain. Anybody can read state. So whatever is on the blockchain, anybody can read it. Not just the person who holds the private key to a certain public key address. No, everybody can read it. But only the person who actually owns the private key can then edit state and send out some lamports or perform a transaction or call a program and perform some actions that change state of this account. A JSON RPC API. So this is the thing that we interact with to work with the Solana blockchain, right? We are the devs on our computer, and then there's the blockchain somewhere distributed amongst all those validators. And we need to have a way to communicate with those validators and tell them, hey, we would like to perform this transaction. Or, hey, we want to read that state. And we do so by calling a remote procedure call. By performing a remote procedure call? Whatever. By RPCing. Yes, yes, that's definitely a word. JavaScript Object Notation Remote Procedure Call Application Programming Interface. Yes, because we like our acronyms. Hypertext Transfer Protocol Post. Essentially, we use the HTTP. I don't want to say protocol because that's already in there. We just use HTTP to tell the RPC, hey, I want this. Can you provide that to me? Thank you. And then in the body, we throw in a JSON where we define what that's supposed to look like. Like we define our transaction and whatnot. The Solana Web 3.js. If you do anything in terms of development on Solana, this is probably the first thing that you'll get around. That's just a library that has some very useful functionality to help you interact with those RPCs to make such remote procedure calls. Yeah, and that is an NPM package. If you don't know what that is, you gotta install Node. That's just JavaScript, essentially. And it has some methods, some JavaScript functions. For example, you can use it to query the Solana balance of an account. So this is the first actual coding example. Inside this Web3.js, we have really helpful classes such as public key or the connection, which then have nice functions like the get balance. So because I said we shouldn't just look at the code and read through the code, we actually wanna code the code. Let's get some IDE running. So new file. TypeScript. I prefer TypeScript over JavaScript because it has types. Yes, a text file and then a story. There's modular one, TypeScript. So every pro knows there should be a copy. James, I have a suggestion for you. Can you make a copy here? Copy source code. If you have tutorials, boom, copy all the source code. That's like handy. Just saying, James, I'm not saying your course is any bad, but yeah, I'm also going to review James's class if it's any good, but I'm pretty sure he did a good job. Anyhow, let's copy some source code in here. So as I said, this public key and this connection, TypeScript natively doesn't know that because that's from the @solana/web3.js library package, whatever. So what we got to do is import. Oh wait, no, let's go the easy way. Just fire up a terminal and say npm install and then this name. Doo-doop. Boom. Install. What that does is it creates a folder called node modules in which it installs the Solana Web3.js package and all the dependencies because it has a few dependencies. So we wait for that to happen. There, then we see here we get a node modules which has the @solana web3 stuff library and also a lot of dependencies from other modules, right? But usually you don't need to look in there. That's all just other people's code that we're not too interested in. I kind of like my green screen. It's not great, but it's okay. There we go. And now we can do stuff like hover here and say quick fix, hover here. That's not working as I thought it would. No quick fixes available. Right, then we gotta do it manually. We gotta say import, maybe because I didn't import it yet, it doesn't suggest that quick fix. And I'm lazy, so I'm just gonna import everything from this thing. Okay, let's not import everything, because then I need to say s. I could be like, that would work. But I don't want to do that, because then I would need to write web3 dot to all of those. The much nicer way is to import it directly. Wait, no. Like this, I import just the things that I need. That's a much cleaner way than this. So we're gonna do that. And the same for the connection. Which is gonna add the connection here. Oh, and this is another function that essentially just gives us the address of the public RPC endpoint of the DevNet cluster. So this will return something like http://api.devnet.solana.com. That's what this essentially is, what is hiding behind this function. My point is, you could do this instead, right? Or if you want to have your custom RPC node, just put the URL in there. Because the connection takes the endpoint as a string. And then you can define commitments. Hey, we are getting ahead of ourselves way too quickly. Let's stay with the get balance. So we've written ourselves a nice asynchronous function to just get the balance of an address. And we put the address in, which is a pub key, right? So put that here and then this returns as a promise. So when that's done, we can say, then give us just the balance on the output. Just some simple TypeScript. You know, I'm not going to teach you TypeScript here. I'm just going to teach you Solana stuff. Because I don't know any TypeScript. I also need to always look that up. But that essentially does a calls that function, awaits it, and then calls... You know TypeScript. I don't teach you. Let's skip that part. So if we now want to just run that, we say tsnode, because we want to run TypeScript, modular 1, and execute. And then we see that we have, in fact, 4... So 0.004 sol on that account, because 4 million... No. Did I make a mistake earlier and said it has a million? No, it's 1,000? A million? Oh, it must be 1 billion lamports. Ah, good thing is that inside the Web3, there's also lamports per sol, which it automatically imports if I do that. And I know what that number looks like. I'm just bad with names. So that's a 1 with 9 zeros. Yeah, a 1 with 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3 zeros. So that's 1 sol in lamports. And that number is called 1 billion, right? 1 billion. Not 1 million. Yeah, 1 billion. Sorry for getting that wrong. Yes, because 1 million doesn't have 9 zeros. God damn it, you stupid Andy. So anyway, the point is this account has 0.004 sol. We can confirm this on, say, Explorer. Oh, by the way, that's also a very good place to get started. If you want to look up anything in the state of Solana, right? On the Solana blockchain, the Explorer or other explorers like SolScan or Solana FM or whatever else there is, they're pretty good in displaying stuff. And they each have like their strengths. I like the Explorer for most of the stuff. And when I work with NFTs, I prefer to switch somewhere else. But for the basics, I really enjoy the explorer.solana.com. And yeah, here we can see the address. That's also the public key of this account. And we can see that it has 0.004. Sorry, as I said, because I'm freaking smart. And it's not even a wallet account. It's just it is an account that belongs to a program. More on that later, probably. Now, we didn't really like do much yet. Since I'm introducing the very basics of Solana, I do want to also encourage you to install the Solana CLI. Not sure if that's coming up in any of the lessons. Okay, but then if you haven't already, you should definitely install the Solana CLI. because it gives you like a lot of very handy commands that you can quickly do. If you don't know how to do that, Google it. Go to docsolana.com, CLI. There you find a guide how to install that in the newest version. I probably do not have the newest version. I'm pretty old, I guess. I'm so old. But I can update. There we go. Updated. Okay. So as I was saying, you should install the Solana CLI such that you can call cool stuff here and also on the keygen, Solana keygen. That allows you to create new addresses. And the way I like to create my addresses is using grind and starts with, because then I can say, this is the wallet from James, my jam wallet. And then it will find me a pub key that starts with jam. Jamie has a wallet. Yes. So this is the James's wallet now. And I can say in my Solana, I mean, we've done this many times if you followed me on this channel, but from the beginning for everybody, we can now set this public key. This is actually the private key. This private key that we just created here, or yeah, found, grinded. So essentially it created us a new private key. That's it. And the corresponding public key starts with Jamie. And I love it. And I can now say Solana config set, and then the key to this, which if I then do any command with the Solana CLI, like Solana airdrop, then it takes this key automatically and I don't need to always say, please use this key. So airdrop works on DevNet, doesn't work on mainnet, who would have thought? Just gives you some lamports to play around with for development purposes, that's super helpful. So for instance, if we wanted to have 0.42 sol, to have almost the same number, just two zeros more, boom, I'm requesting the airdrop. And now I'm already, you know, talking through an RPC with the Solana DevNet and it gives me that back. Solana balance will then tell me, oh yes, I have 0.42 sol. That's how you would do it with a CLI. On the dev side, like if you're dealing with TypeScript, then that's what that looks like. And if we were to copy that address and put it in here and save it and then start up this again, then we will see, okay, we have 420 million, which corresponds to 0.42 sol lamports. And if you want to deal with sol, you could be like multiplying those lamports in here. And then you say, this is sol now. Also works. Easy, 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 easy. Boom. What? Of course you divide. I always get that wrong. I told you, I'm not good with numbers and I can't read. So 0.42 sol, there you go. Easy as that, easy as that. We can read balance from any Solana account. Wow. We've made it so far in the tutorial already. And I've been recording for 40 minutes. Okay, this is gonna take a while to get me through that course, I guess. But I mean, I guess the TLDR is fine, right? I mean, we did the TLDR, now we're good. Because this is just text. Man, I don't like to read. Wait, I can't read. There must be a better way. If you trust the developer, of course I trust the developer.
Read data from the Solana network.
Uses text-to-speech technology to convert web page text to audio.
No, that's better. Okay, I mean, that sounds most like James. I guess I've never heard James talk. I've never even met him, but probably a great guy. Now, can you read from here? You know, there is one reason, and one reason only, to use Microsoft Edge. And that is the read aloud feature.
Solana accounts are similar to files in.
But you don't sound like James. Still not. Anna, you're not James. Is there a James? James. Huh, James. So we gotta let James read to us. Yeah.
Data and are flexible in.
James, you really sound weird.
Enough to be used in many different ways.
You sound like a freaking Indian expat or some. I don't know. Maybe not James.
Solana's native token, more on that later.
I mean, this sounds like James. This is how I imagine James. Welcome to a Solana tutorial where we learn about text-to-speech voices. Oh man.
Here's an executable code.
This is like, has the power it needs. Okay, let's start. From the top. Let's
go. Accounts. They hold arbitrary, persistent data and are flexible enough to be used in many different ways. Custom data structures and executable code that can be run as programs.
Yeah, everything is accounts. Everything that you want to deploy a program, bytecode is stored in accounts. Send SOL to a wallet, it's a new account. Send tokens around, all accounts. Tokens are accounts, and token accounts are accounts. Anyway, more on that later, because he likes to say that as well.
Public keys, they are often shown as base 58 encoded strings like 74 JSP.
Okay, yeah, that's a good information that we should have probably also mentioned. Those public keys, like, that's usually what that looks like. It's base 58 encoded. That's important. What is base 58, Andy? Well, it's a way of encoding. And it takes the numbers, the bytes, and basically compresses it. Just that makes it shorter. So those 32 bytes, there, it takes a byte and makes a corresponding character sequence of it. And base 58 essentially means there are 58 characters in this encoding. So it's like base 64, but it throws out a few letters that are easily mixed, like the lowercase l, because it's easily confused with a 1, the uppercase o, because it's easily confused with a 0, also the 0, because it's easily confused with the uppercase o, so they just threw them out. Yeah, so if you have a uppercase o or a 0 in your address, then you know it can't be a base 58 address, and therefore can't be a Solana address. Right, okay, starting to sprinkle more, huh? Sprinkly. Thank you, James. Let's look at this graph. Look at this graph. What does it tell us? Now we have programs. So if you're a developer, you can write your programs in Rust or C or C++. This is in the later modules. We're gonna do that. And we can deploy that to Solana. So the validators will then have an account which stores the bytecode and accounts which store the actual data that the program uses. And as a client, this is what we're doing now, either with our CLI or with TypeScript or whatever, really. We can do an RPC call and also interact with the network. And the RPC call can either be a transaction where we want to change something on the network or a query where we want to just read something from the network. So the query, the get balance, for instance, that was a query. Because we didn't change the state. If you want to change state, we got to send a transaction, which then needs to be confirmed by the validators. Yeah, there you go. I have that explained without actually reading, because I'm a teacher. That's how I do.
The Solana JSON RPC API.
There we go.
In practice, this specification simply involves sending a JSON object representing a method you want to call. This needs to be exactly end quote, 2.0 end quote.
So needs to be exactly 2.0. The version number should be 2, like this. James, make that look better here. This is not interpreted. It should just be this. So here we are sending something to the RPC manually. I've actually never done that manually, so maybe that's a good exercise. An identifier, can be a string or whole number. The name of the method you want to invoke. And parameters. And in this case, the parameter is just going to be the address, right? So for our get balance, it would look like this. We fetch. So this is not from the Solana Web 3 now. This is just a common fetch, like a, which is make an HTTP post request. Say, hey, we have some JSON in the payload, in the body. And then the actual body is the JSON of that with the four parameters as described above. And then we have our get balance. So can't copy like this, okay. Let's try out this code as well. And then instead of calling it conveniently from the connection, which hides the RPC manually, we can do it like this. So we just call with the public key to base 58. So if we have already the public key and we wanna get out this thing again, then we just call to base 58. So putting that in here, that's then my parameter. And then we post that, we call fetch. And when the fetch gives us a promise on the response, then the response, the RPC, what we get back again in the body contains a JSON object. So that's what the body.json, that's what this returns us. And then from the JSON, we can say, okay, if there's an error, we throw the error, but that's not going to happen. Otherwise, we just get the result as a number. We can look at the entire result. No, at the entire JSON, why not? Let's look at the entire JSON. Yeah, it returns the thing as a number. So we can essentially do the same thing that we did here. This. And then we get the result as a number and we can print it as well like that. So let's try if that would run. Modulo 1. Nope, that doesn't run because we effed something up. Right, so we didn't include fetch, of course. I mean, I said that I won't teach the basics, right? But the problem is I don't know the basics myself. James, I think I need a crash course on TypeScript first before I can do your course. This is... On the other hand, I did manage to get fetch to work at one point. Where did I do that? I can do the ugly hack again. Not like I want to do this, but... again, we don't want to learn TypeScript. We want to learn Solana. So let's just assume that fetch is working. Now I overwrote it and it doesn't show me properly what those things are anymore. Anyway, let's hope it just works. Yeah, there you go. It's such an ugly hack though. But yeah, I mean, basically do your own research to get fetch to work, I guess. Well, that's annoying. Anyway, we were here. And we did that as it instructed us. And then with a short break to make fetch work, we get here where it prints the entire JSON that comes back from the RPC, which is this part. So that's what we get back from our RPC call. Also version 2.0, also ID, and it will mirror that back. And then the result, so this is what it now provides us. It puts a field result into the JSON where it gives the value. That's what we're actually looking for. And then it also sets some context, like a version and which slot we're on. So this is Solana state, because it's a slot machine. The world's biggest slot machine. No, don't make jokes to people who are just learning. They actually take what you say seriously. State machine. It's a state machine. And we have the 420 million lamports, which are 0.42 sol. So far, so good. Now we can also do that with calling the JSON RPC API directly. Boom. However, it is much neater to use the connection from the library though. Must admit, because that hides all of this stuff. Because who needs that? Right, back to you, James. What else?
We're going to use the URL for the DevNet cluster rather than mainnet. As the name suggests, this cluster is designed for developer use and testing.
But James, what is testnet then? Isn't that for testing? Oh yeah, that's more for the validators. And anyway, more on clusters later. I always get ahead of ourselves. Okay, now let's read from the network.
Let's create a simple website.
Oh great, we can do some websites. I love it. Let's just git clone us this in here. Now, what's inside this Solana front end? Get oriented. Take a look around. All right, so he has his own coding examples here. We don't need to code every single piece of code that he puts in. Fine. I'll remember for next time, James. I'll remember. You did a nice didactical setup of your course. I like it. Oh yeah, I mean, I think if I go through the first challenge of the first module, this is gonna be enough for an entire video. Like, way enough. Yeah, so let's have a look around. Got the index. That's just containing one of these address from thingies. And we got some styling stuff. npm run dev. So, because what that does, if you look in here, it's just next def. So, it uses next as a dependency. So, we gotta install that as well. That's also just a package in npm. So, we gotta just npm install. So it says npm install this, but that won't be enough. I can just be like in this folder npm I, and it will install anything from the package.json anyway. That includes the Solana Web3 stuff. So now that this is done, we also have a nodes module in here where we once again installed the Solana. No, we did. We did not. Where is it? Is it at Solana? Yeah, it's at Solana. We also installed the Solana Web3 stuff. One more time. Okay, but now if I say npm run dev, now next should be here. Yes, look at that. And it starts as a server on localhost port 3000. 3000! And if we go there, we see this neat little prepared thing for us here. Yeah, yeah, okay. I mean, the green screen looks really good now. Now the green screen looks good. Yeah, that's how I like it. And if we were to put in an address, wow, wow, it queries the network and results in this result. What? Amazing. Who would have thought that the exact same call as we already had it does the exact same thing as we already had it, just with a front end now. Yes, okay. Essentially, we've built us, like he built a nice front end for that as well, such that we can query that. I mean, wait, isn't that already all done? Four, handle invalid addresses. Is that already implemented? So let's say if we had Jamie zero, that must be, there you go. So that's also already implemented. Was I supposed to get something else and then play around with it such that that's implemented? I don't know. Because like, see, if I start with this repo, as you said, that I should start here. And then everything's already implemented, then I'm just like, okay, it works. I don't need to do anything. And then I don't learn anything either. Grand ambitions. Have a look at the complete solution. So this is Solana intro. Ah, here we're just going through the starter. Okay. So, I mean, this was not obvious enough for me that tree starter. I don't quite get it. This doesn't look like the starter code to me. Anyway, essentially just a try catch around this thing, because as soon as we get bell, if we put in a key. So the two things that happened here, first, it already failed here because that's not a valid public key. It's not a base 58 address. And if the connection fails, we would also get an error here. But you know, whatever. We did it. We have a functioning site. Yes. Wow. We did it. We downloaded a Git repo and then we started it. Wow. Okay. Let's do the challenge. Let's do the freaking challenge then. And then we call it a day. James, can you read that? I'm just too lazy to read.
Since this is the first challenge, we'll keep it simple.
Oh, thank you, James.
Go ahead and add on to the front end.
All right. So the challenge is to see if an account is executable or not. Well, that should be simple enough because executable is just another field in the account. So the hard part is figuring out where this line is. And here I want to have is executable. Is it executable question mark? And then if it's executable, yep. And if not, nope. Let's save that. So where does it get that from? I mean, I kind of want to use a Boolean. I could use something else so that I have a third state for, I have no idea, but let's just use, yeah, there we go. So is executable? Nope. But even if we were to put in an account that is executable, it would still say nope because we just say it's false. So we need to actually set the state properly. Where are we going to do that? So there we set balance. I mean, the way I would go about this is just make another call because this get balance hides a lot of stuff with the account and I need the account info. Yeah, it even hints that I should use the get account info method. All right, so he would also do it like that. Okay, cool. So we say first connection so that I also change my style a bit. Get account info, and here I just need the public key again, so I get the key, and then I say then, so when the promise comes back, what does this return? This returns me an account info. So account info, and here we just set is executable to whatever we get from the account info, because that has a field executable. Wow. 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 Such difficult coding exercises. Well, yeah, I mean, if you've never worked with that, then that is difficult. Get account info essentially just queries all of the information from an account. I mean, I'm pretty sure that get balance is also what that does, and get balance then gets from the account info.lamports the balance. So essentially, if we were to want to do this more efficiently, we could comment that out and set the balance like so. I mean, I can also say, no, I'm pretty sure that you have that. So this is just if I can't query the account, but we have a catch here anyway, so the error will be thrown in case there is one. So let's try this. Let's go here and see if I put in my James address here. If I check that, okay. Did you see how it took a while for that to set? That was the promise resolving, right? So I sent to the RPC, the address was set immediately, but then only when it came back, it set this and this, but this is still nope. And then James, you have an address for me which is executable on DevNet. Check that. Boom. This is executable. Yep. Yep. It's executable. Yep. Yep. I do want to find out one more thing though. Since I completed this challenge now, I can do this. I can do this. I can also have a look at the how he did it. The solution. How did we do in comparison to his solution? Oh, he did it like that. Okay, that's a cleaner solution, right? Okay, because I was like, no, you are here 100%. But instead I could be like, but if you're not here, then take false. Throws less errors if the account info is undefined. And same thing I could do here as well. You know, something like this or that. This would probably be the nicer way to write it. Now, I wanna, now that I'm done with this, go back here. Oh, I can just click it myself and be like, we did it. I did it. Yes, my friends, we did it. We completed the first task of the first module of the Solana development course, developed by James and others. And yeah, I think I'm gonna leave it here for today. I think, or I hope that you learned something. If not, go through this one more time by yourself. Take all the time that you need to read through it properly, to maybe even read up on some NPM and fetch stuff. I hope that me going through this with you is helpful. If it is, please tell me so in the comments. If it is not, please tell me so in the comments. And this was just the first of many, potentially, videos where we go through this course. Next time, we're gonna write data to the network. Actually, sending transactions to change state. Yes, because today we were just reading. And that took us over 2 hours. So therefore, we're gonna leave the writing to the next episode. Cool. Boom. Okay, we're back to green. Back to green! I can have my editor put something in the background if he likes to. Anyway, so yeah, today we're just giving a quick introduction to Solana development. We've laid the foundation. You know, we've laid the stones for the foundation to properly develop on Solana in the future. You got to go through the basics in the beginning such that you have the understanding, such that you can develop proper programs on Solana. This is all a process. And I'm happy that you're here with me going through that process. Thank you to the Solana Foundation for sponsoring this episode. They're giving me a grant to make some videos on that course. So yes, they're essentially the sponsor of this video. I mean, they didn't tell me to say that, but thank you, Solana Foundation, for supporting me. Andy, you're such a sellout. Yes, yes, I am. I am such a sellout. I now made paid content about Solana. Yeah, first of all, I have an editor who can edit the video so I can produce more. Yes. And secondly, I can produce more so you can look forward to more videos. If you don't want to miss them, hit subscribe, like the video as well to let other people know that this content is good. Or dislike it to tell me that it's shit. I can also live with that. I want constructive feedback. If you want me to go through it in any other kind of way, yes, I'm totally open for feedback. Let me know in the comments or in my Discord server. And yeah, I will see you next time. You can also check out those videos that I made about Solana stuff. And enjoy your development journey.
I shall see you in the next one.